Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome. Episode 111, Phase 1 Complete. The Battle of Abritus forced the Romans to deal with something they had never before had to face, the death of an emperor in battle. Up until now, emperors had died of natural causes, or they had been assassinated, or they had committed suicide, but never had they fallen to an enemy sword. The gods struck down emperors, or the Romans struck down emperors, or emperors struck down themselves, but they were not knocked off by some common barbarian warrior. It simply wasn't done. But while this humiliating blow to the national psyche was immense, the Romans did not have long to dwell on their misery, because there was one big practical problem the death of Decius had left them with. Who would rule now? The elevation of Decius' son Herennius to the rank of co-emperor just a few months earlier was supposed to have solved this problem, but he too had died at Abritus, leaving the empire not just without a leader, but without a leader in its darkest hour. To extract the empire from this predicament, the Senate and the army both came up with solutions to the problem of who would rule. Unfortunately, they were different solutions. The army naturally chose to elevate one of their own, specifically the senior-ranking officer left on the scene after the disaster at Abritus, Gaius Vibius Trebonianus Gallus. Back in Rome, though, the Senate chose to stick with the hereditary rights of Decius's family and elected Gaius Valens Hostilianus Messius Quintus, Decius's youngest son, who had been left behind in Rome while his father and brother had gone off to fight the Goths. The big justifiable fear after Decius' death was that some kind of civil war would break out at a moment when a lack of internal unity might prove fatal. And with the Senate and armies backing separate candidates for the throne, that seemed to be the deadly path Rome was headed down. But the inevitable confrontation between Hostilian and Gallus never arrived, in part because Gallus decided that circumstances demanded that someone take the high road and offer a compromise. Sitting in a tent out near the Danube, surrounded by the remnants of an army that had just been annihilated by the Goths, Gallus recognized that this was no time for a civil war. If he wasted the time and energy of what was left of Decius's army on some power grab, the Goths could just sweep down, conquer the Middle Empire, and split Rome in half. So while he made it clear to the Senate that he planned to accept the army's acclaim, he also made it clear that he had no problem with Hostilian serving as his co-emperor. He was able to come to this magnanimous conclusion because, one, he had always been on excellent terms with Decius and his family and did not instinctively see Hostilian as a rival, and two, the age difference between them, Hostilian was still a teenager, meant that Gallus would always be the senior Augustus. Accepting Hostilian, then, was more like accepting an heir than a true colleague. Plus, it's not like the Moesian legions were in any condition to force their demands on anyone. Though it seems a bit crazy to think about, Trebonianus Gallus was a rare figure at this point in Roman history. He was an emperor of fully Italian extraction. Since the fall of the Flavian dynasty, the imperial office had been populated by Spaniards and Africans and Thracians and Illyrians, but only on a few rare occasions was the emperor of Rome actually an Italian. Now, of course, we can't read too much into this, as many of these emperors, the Trajans and Hadrians and Severans of the world, either came from Italian families transplanted into the provinces, or from provincial families who had married into important Italian clans. But still, it is worth noting that an emperor born in Italy to an Italian family had, by the 3rd century, become something of an endangered species. Gallus was born into a senatorial family of Etruscan origin, and had spent his life working his way up the cursus honorum, serving in civilian and military posts across the empire. At some point, he became an associate of Decius's, and when Decius became emperor, he immediately appointed Gallus to govern the province of Upper Moesia. The appointment underscores the close working relationship between the two men, as the governorship of Upper Moesia was no honorary ambassadorship to Tahiti. This was, after all, a territory not only being harassed by the Goths, but which had also been ground zero for the rebellion that had put Decius in power in the first place. The degree to which Decius trusted and respected Gallus is obvious, and the new governor quickly became trusted and respected by the men under his command as well. A full bronze statue of Gallus still exists that depicts a large, barrel-chested man with close-cropped hair, cutting and imposing figure. He was not some aristocratic dandy the Moesian legions could hope to push around. Not that they had time for such bullying. Gallus took over in 250 AD, and for the next 18 months he led the Roman response to the increasing Gothic raids. Sometimes he was successful, and sometimes he wasn't, but no one could argue that Gallus wasn't exerting maximum effort in an attempt to stem the barbarian tribe. When Cniva invaded with a full force, though, the Moesian legions were simply unable to do anything to stop him, and Gallus was one of those provincial leaders who told Decius in no uncertain terms that the lower Danube needed reinforcements and fast. He then served as one of Decius's key generals during the campaign against the Gothic king, and wound up being one of the few to escape from Abritus alive. As I said at the end of last week's show, Gallus took over what was left of the legions and came to an understanding with the victorious Cniva. The Romans would not hinder the Gothic retreat back across the Danube, and henceforth, payment would be made annually to the Gothic king to prevent him from attacking in the future. Though later Romans would castigate Gallus for this ignoble peace, modern scholars seem more than willing to give him a pass. He was in an incredibly difficult position, and doing the best he could to save the empire from further humiliation. The rumor that he and Cniva were in cahoots started up a few years later, but no one at the time, and no one now, really believes that those smears hold much water. The men of the shattered legions who had just elected him emperor certainly didn't think he was a traitor who had just gotten most of them killed. Otherwise, they would have torn him limb from limb, rather than giving him the keys to the empire. The peace deal with Cniva is evidence that Gallus was of a mind to walk the Romans away from the Battle of Abritus without making things any worse than they already were. But the external threat posed by the Goths was not the only source of potential peril. Gallus also had to make a choice about how to deal with the Senate's elevation of Hostilian. In this, too, Gallus showed that he was more interested in making sure things didn't get worse than he was in just about anything else. So he sent a letter to the Senate informing them that their choice of Hostilian was a fine one, and that he would be happy to share the imperial insignia with the son of Decius. The Senate was no more disposed to start up a civil war than Gallus was, and immediately accepted the compromise. With the Goths temporarily sated, Gallus and a few key advisors made their way back to Rome to meet with Hostilian and the Senate so that together they could work up for a plan on how to stabilize the empire, which was clearly teetering on the brink of something. When he arrived back in the capital, Gallus and Hostilian were acclaimed as the co-Augusti of Rome, and Gallus' son Volusianus was named Caesar and eventual heir to the throne. The partnership between Gallus and Hostilian, though, wouldn't last the year. In the summer of 251, Hostilian mysteriously vanished from the historical record, and we can only guess at what happened to him. Gallus' conspiracy theorists claimed that the young Augustus had been offed by the evil betrayer of Abritus, but the consensus opinion seems to be that Hostilian fell victim to a new plague that had chosen this inopportune moment to appear on the scene, the Cyprian Plague, so named because its effects were described in detail by Saint Cyprian, the Bishop of Carthage. As with the Antonine Plague, there is some debate over which particular disease ravaged the empire for the next 20 years, but again, as with the Antonine Plague, smallpox appears to be the likely culprit. If there is one recent cliche that I have really come to loathe, it is the cliche of the quote, perfect storm. Everyone these days wants to describe everything as a perfect storm, making it hard to distinguish when an incredibly rare confluence of events produces something historically destructive, and when someone just wants to use the phrase, a perfect storm, to lend whatever minor crisis they're describing some dramatic heft. Really, I promise you, the overuse of a perfect storm is a big pet peeve of mine. With that in mind, the crisis of the 3rd century was a perfect storm. The empire was already being ravaged by external pressures stronger than it had known in centuries. Violent internal political division, economic depression, soaring taxation, and now, on top of everything else, a massive plague was breaking out. You guys, this is what a perfect storm looks like. At the height of the Cyprian plague, which ran from 251 until sometime after 270, 5,000 people died every day in Rome, and the bodies piled up faster than they could be buried. Manpower shortages inevitably resulted in the fields and in the army barracks, leading to further economic depression, famine, and anemic border defense. This at a time when the last thing the empire could afford was economic depression, famine, and anemic border defense. Besides Hostilian, the plague would eventually claim the life of the Emperor Claudius Gothicus as well, a man who was well on his way to leading Rome out of the darkness when he died prematurely in his camp. Really, I will never stop marveling at how the Roman Empire was able to survive the 3rd century. Everyone always wants to know why Rome fell, but I think the more fascinating question is how it managed to survive as long as it did. Over the course of the next few episodes, I hope to get to the bottom of that particular mystery. Seriously, these were bad times that the Romans should not have lived through. Though the Romans had been focused for the last few years on the threat in the north posed by the Goths, it was during the short reign of Gallus that they were reminded that the Sassanids still posed a major threat in the east. Sharpur had been biding his time after making peace with Philip the Arab back in 244, but once word trickled over to the Sassanid king that the Romans were getting battered around by a Gothic invasion, it did not take him long to call an army back into the field and point them west. The strength of Rome was at a low ebb, and now was the perfect opportunity to maybe peel off some of that old Persian territory his family had been coveting all these years. The results of Sharpur's campaign would prove as disastrous to the Romans as Caniva's campaign had just been, and when the Romans finally got around to responding, the results of that campaign would prove to be even more disastrous still. Bad times. Bad, bad times. As is so often the case in Roman history, Armenia lay at the center of this latest outbreak of hostilities between East and West. The chronology on all of this is a bit muddled, but it appears that Sharpur used a dispute over Armenian succession as a pretext for invading the Buffer Kingdom. After marching around unopposed and placing his own man on the throne, Sharpur then shocked everyone by directly invading the Roman province of Syria. As had just happened in the north, the eastern legions were so used to simply keeping watch without any real fear of direct attack that the sudden invasion caught them completely by surprise. Sharpur captured key legionary garrisons and sacked important cities, including, amazingly, Antioch itself. After his string of victories, Sharpur chose to withdraw from Syria as winter descended, rather than attempt an occupation at this early stage in the game. Rome may be weakened, but it certainly wasn't defenseless. The easy success of his initial foray into Roman territory, though, had to have had Sharpur's mouth watering. Back in Rome, the surprising news of this marauding Sassanid army was met by an equally surprising reaction from the Emperor Gallus, relative indifference. He ordered the Syrian legions to regroup and defend themselves properly the next time Sharpur came calling, but other than that, he made no move to travel to Syria himself or to raise emergency reinforcements to help shore up the Eastern Front. This latter bit is at least somewhat understandable, as the North was already stretched dangerously thin, and the plague was making recruiting difficult. But there's no getting around the fact that Gallus did not seem much moved by the danger posed by the Sassanids. Perhaps had he lived, he would have done as Valerian eventually did, and led the counterattack personally. But Romans at the time whispered that perhaps there was more soft Italian in Gallus than he liked to let on, and that the luxuries of Rome were seducing him away from his responsibilities. Discontentment with Gallus, as you can imagine, began to grow apace from this point on. With all of this swirling around, bad news once again came down from the Danube in 253. Caniva let it be known that he was unhappy about the payments he had been promised, and if Gallus didn't do something about it, the Gothic king was going to consider their peace treaty null and void. It is unclear whether the Romans were actually withholding the funds they had promised, or whether Caniva was simply trying to extort more cash from his weakened opponent, but the word went back up to give the Gothic king no more than he had already been given. Caniva, insulted, made preparations for a new invasion of the empire. After Gallus left for Rome, the man put in charge of the northern border was Marcus Aemilius Aemilianus, a general of North African extraction who had been appointed to a legionary command in Moesia by Decius and promoted to overall command by Gallus following the disaster at Abritus. Aemilianus faced the frightening prospect of dealing with the same Gothic army that had just whipped the Romans handily, only this time with fewer men and more raw recruits. The odds, needless to say, were not in his favor. When Caniva did cross the Danube in 253, though, the Gothic king let his arrogance get the better of him, and Aemilianus was able to surprise the Goths and deliver a smashing victory for the legions. This time, it was Caniva who found himself leading off the wounded remnants of a once mighty army, and the world was reminded that the Romans were not done for yet. Aemilianus was an overnight sensation, and for having done what two emperors had been unable to do, the exuberant troops honored their general the best way they knew how. They proclaimed him emperor. And if you think that by acclaiming their fourth emperor in just 5 years, the Moesian legions were hitting the peak of their fickleness, well, let's just give it another 3 months. The news that the men who had proclaimed him emperor were now proclaiming someone else emperor finally roused Gallus from his apparent slumber. He sent an order up to Valerian, the commander of the Upper Rhine, and the man Decius had tried to make censor, demanding that Valerian lead his troops to Italy at once to help Gallus smack down this would-be usurper. The emperor then induced the Senate to declare Aemilianus an enemy of the state, and he gathered up a defense force and marched north to prevent the Moesian legions from entering Italy. But Aemilianus was well aware that time was of the essence, and while Gallus gathered his defenses, the Moesian general was already marching on Italy to cement his claim to the throne. The Danube legions had been weakened by war and disease, and if Aemilianus was to have any shot at all at unseating Gallus, he needed to strike before the emperor could muster all the forces at his disposal. If he was thinking in particular about the Rhine legions, then he was right to move fast. By getting to Gallus before the Rhine troops did, he was able to emerge victorious from something approaching an equal contest. Not that it did him much good. Fast or slow, when the Rhine legions did arrive, Aemilianus found himself done for anyway. But we'll get to that in a minute. Aemilianus was already in Italy and speeding down the eastern branch of the Flaminian Way when he was finally met by an army led by Gallus and Volusianus. There are two accounts of what happened next. The first states that Aemilianus defeated Gallus after a short battle and that Gallus and his son then fled north to await the coming Rhine reinforcements. Their way was then cut short by members of the Praetorian Guard, who saw the wind shifting in Aemilianus's favor, and figured that they could get in good with the new emperor by bringing him the head of the old. They murdered Gallus and Volusianus, leaving Aemilianus's path to the throne clear. The other account is that there was no battle at all, and that Gallus's troops defected to Aemilianus before a single spear was thrown, leaving Gallus and Volusianus alone and unprotected, at which point they were executed by Aemilianus. Whichever way it happened, by the end of August 253, Gallus was dead. He was 47 years old and had ruled the empire for 2 years. The death of Gallus ushered in the glorious reign of Emperor Aemilianus, which began the moment Gallus died and ended the moment Valerian arrived in Italy with the Rhine legions. This glorious reign probably lasted about a month. When the new emperor arrived in Rome, he was greeted coolly by the Senate. Gallus had not been their first choice to lead the empire, and they were probably no more pleased with his lingering in the capital than anyone else, but he had gone out of his way to avoid civil war by proposing joint rule with Hostilian. Civil war was the last thing the empire needed, and here now was a man who had gone ahead and started one anyway. Aemilianus was not unaware of his standing in the capital, so when he arrived, he went to great lengths to convince the Senate of his benign intentions. He told the senators that he saw himself merely as a general, and that he had neither the time nor the inclination to be the political, economic, and moral leader of the empire. That, he said, would be the Senate's responsibility. He himself would be too busy defending Rome from its foreign enemies to worry about politics. He planned, he said, to be but an instrument of the empire, and more specifically, an instrument of the Senate. Their egos now more than satisfied, any opposition to Aemilianus washed away as they contemplated this enticing new dynamic he had proposed, a partnership between the military and the civilian authorities, rather than all power being claimed by a single man. It was a positively intoxicating thought for the power-starved Senate. But like I say, the glorious reign of Aemilianus only lasted a few weeks. Valerian had never stopped moving south after the death of Gallus, and he now entered Italy in mid to late 253 with an eye not on saving Gallus, but revenging him. Aemilianus' position was now reversed, and just a few weeks after marching down the Flaminian Way to confront Gallus, he found himself marching right back up it again to confront Valerian. On the same eastern branch of the road, though a bit further south, the two commanders met at the heads of their respective armies. Overawed by both the larger force from the Rhine and by the reputation of Valerian, the Moesian legions once again abandoned their master in favor of another and defected en masse to Valerian. In the process of this defection, Aemilianus was cornered and killed by his own officers so that there would be no misunderstanding where their new loyalties lay. Aemilianus was in his early 40s and had enjoyed the novelty of calling himself emperor for just about 3 months. The death of Aemilianus closes out the first phase of the crisis of the 3rd century. This first phase, running roughly from 238 to 253, set the tone for the remainder of the crisis. The legions elevating and abandoning emperors, the Goths invading from the north, the Sassanids invading from the east, the Cyprian plague sucking the life out of Rome's army and economy, and in general, the bonds that had held the empire together fraying to the breaking point. During the middle phase, all of these factors would combine to explode Rome into an anarchic mess. Lasting from 253 to 268, this middle phase will be defined by the reigns of Valerian and his son Gallienus. Now, in the context of the times, the 15-year combined reign of Valerian and his son seems to indicate a level of stability, but in fact, it masks instability on a scale that would only be matched during the final decades of the 400s AD as the West fell apart completely. those of you who have read ahead know that not only did imperial usurpers rise and fall faster during this middle phase of the crisis than at any other period in Roman history, but also that beginning in the 260s, the empire would actually spend about 15 years divided into thirds after new kingdoms in the northwest and east successfully broke away from Rome. The final phase of the crisis, which lasted roughly from the death of Gallienus in 268 until the elevation of Diocletian in 284, was the recovery period, during which a series of vigorous emperors from Illyria battled back through the chaos to reestablish the supremacy of Rome, both internally and externally. Next time, we'll open the middle phase of the crisis with the elevation of Valerian and his son Gallienus. Though Valerian was at the time one of the most respected men in the empire, his destiny was unfortunately to go down in history as an imperial embarrassment. To his credit, he immediately opened up a war in the east to punish the Sassanids for their sack of Syria. But when he was captured alive by Sharpur in 260, his name became synonymous with the general felling of once mighty Rome. There will be no episode next week as I am headed down to the Austin City Limits Music Festival, but we'll be back in 2 weeks to see just how bad we can make things for the Romans. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome, episode 112, Captured Alive. In the autumn of 253 AD, the troops supporting short-lived Emperor Aemilius Aemilianus abandoned the man they had so recently elevated to the purple and defected en masse to Valerian. I think we can forgive the Romans for at first not investing too much emotional energy in this newly appointed emperor, because, after all, in the 18 years since the assassination of Alexander Severus, the empire had seen 11 different men claim the title Augustus. There was absolutely no reason to believe that the new emperor would not simply come and go along with all the rest. But when Valerian descended from the Alps, he wound up bringing with him 15 years of relative stability at the top of the political pyramid, at least in a sense. Sure, the western provinces of Gaul, Britannia, Hispania, Germania Superior, Germania Inferior, and Raetia would break away in 260, losses that would be matched in that year when Syria, Egypt, Palestine, and most of Asia Minor came under the control of the city of Palmyra. But the middle of the empire, Greece and the Balkans and Italy, would, from 253 to 268, be the domains of Valerian and his son, Publius Licinius Ignatius Gallienus, and their reign will form the bridge between the old empire of Augustus and Hadrian and Marcus Aurelius and the coming empire of Diocletian and Constantine and Theodosius. Now, whether the fractured stability of Gallienus was more dangerous than the unified political anarchy that preceded him is a question scholars still debate today. As soon as Valerian's claim to power was recognized by the Senate in October 253, he wasted no time inducing them to further elevate his son Gallienus to the rank of co-Augustus. Having two emperors was a critical part of Valerian's plan for the empire, and indeed, the rapidity with which he began to pursue that plan have left some questioning whether or not the new emperor had dragged his feet a little getting out of Germany. That maybe, after receiving the distress call from Gallus, that Valerian decided to simply let Gallus and Aemilianus fight it out, which would allow him to sweep down and brush aside whoever was left standing after the showdown. But whether he was actively planning for what he would do when he became emperor, or whether he just had an idea of what he would do if he became emperor, there was very little separating Valerian's elevation to the throne and the announcement that he was heading to Syria to reassert Roman power in the east. The main point of rising up Gallienus was so that Valerian could be sure that the Western Empire was left in loyal hands while he focused on the Eastern Front. This division of the empire followed the previous division of Marcus Aurelius and Lucius Verus a century before, though this time it was the senior Augusti who went east, with his junior partner remaining in Rome. One of the big problems we have in dealing with the crisis of the 3rd century is that establishing a definitive chronology through the chaos is almost impossible. What sources we have are contradictory and full of biases and outright fabrications. For example, even when we deal with a momentous event like Aurelian's evacuation of Dacia, all we can say is that it happened sometime between 271 and 274. Everything else is just guesswork. We can make good guesses, but they are nonetheless still guesses. Just how crossed up the history of the mid-3rd century can get begins to really become apparent during the joint reign of Valerian and Gallienus. For the next little while, dates are going to fall in ranges, and a lot of question marks are going to surround where people were and when they were there. We know basically what happened and basically what order it happened in, but sometimes, well, we really don't. That all being said, probably by early 254, Valerian was headed to Syria to survey the damage wrought by the recent Sassanid invasion. Gallienus, meanwhile, headed up north to the Rhine on a mission to repel Germanic incursions that had begun the minute Valerian picked up the legions guarding the border and marched them to Italy. The pattern of these northern invasions would become a familiar one over the next 20-odd years and highlight the cyclical nature of the 3rd century crisis. Anytime border troops were called elsewhere to deal with some emergency, barbarians beyond the frontier would invade the under-garrisoned territory left behind, forcing troops from elsewhere to be called in and plug the gap, leading to invasions in whatever territory those troops had just left behind, and so on and so on. Then, whatever territory was left holding the bag would have to look to their local commander to engineer a defense, and if he succeeded despite imperial aid, his troops would generally hail him as emperor, precipitating a civil war, forcing the existing emperor to come put down the uprising, and then the cycle would start all over again. Valerian's withdrawal of the Rhine legions to help him win power in Italy precipitated the beginning of one of these long cycles. Germanic tribes took the opportunity to pour across the border and raid the wealth of Gaul. The junior emperor's arrival in country seems to have brought an end to the pillaging, and between 253 and 255, Gallienus seems to have won a number of, if they can't quite be called battles, then at least significant skirmishes that forced the various tribes to withdraw back across the Rhine. Valerian, meanwhile, passed through the Balkans and marched across Asia Minor on his way to Syria. While he was on the move, the Goths and other associated tribes beyond the Danube appear to have prudently waited for the imperial army to pass before they renewed their forays into Roman territory. As soon as Valerian was gone, though, various independent Gothic groups once again began descending south in search of the great wealth of the Roman Empire. Valerian, though, had much bigger things on his plate than the Goths, who, though they had done damage to the empire's ego, were still small potatoes compared to the truly existential threat posed by the Sassanids. Where the Goths were dangerous rabble, the Sassanids were a well-organized rival civilization in the fullest sense of the word. And their attacks on the east threatened not just the rich provinces of Syria and Asia Minor, which accounted for a great deal of imperial tax revenue, but also the all-important province of Egypt and its critical grain supply. Valerian planted his court at Antioch, and for the next few years he rebuilt the Syrian capital and the infrastructure of the surrounding countryside. At some point, he retook the border city of Nisibis, and by 257, things were mostly back to the way they had been before Shapur's great raid of 253. The Sassanid king could only sit back and watch the Romans regroup, as the presence of the emperor and his army were enough to make him think twice about simply repeating his invasion of a few years before. Of course, with Valerian in Syria and Gallienus in Gaul, The Danube frontier became the odd man out, and, as I just said, Gothic armies began to once again pour south across the river. Sometime around 255, this new invasion forced Gallienus to march in from the west and reinforce the Middle Empire. With the emperor on the scene, or should I say, with the resources the emperor brought with him on the scene, the Romans were able to once again plug the northern leak and push the Goths back across the river. But as Gallienus campaigned in the Middle Empire, the West inevitably slid back into chaos, forcing the junior emperor to head back to Gaul. Hoping to keep everyone in line after he was gone, Gallienus elevated his son, Valerian II, to the rank of Caesar, and left the young man as the figurehead of record for all the Danube provinces. Actual administration of the provinces, though, was, critically, left in the hands of a general by the name of Ingenius, who we will have cause to deal with in just a moment. The invasion Gallienus rushed back to deal with eventually became serious enough to draw all three members of the imperial tripartite to the Lower Rhine. Valerian took a gamble that he would be able to leave the east in the hands of subordinates without triggering an invasion by Sharpur, and, with Syria mostly rebuilt, he headed to Gaul in 257 to personally oversee the situation. That gamble would not pay off. As soon as Valerian left, the Sassanids were once again on the move. Obviously, this raises the question, what in the world could have been so serious that it brought Valerian all the way back from Syria to face? The answer lies in a super confederation of Germanic tribes making their first, but certainly not last appearance in the history of Rome, the Franks. The Franks, who in time would become the reason why we call France France and not Gaul, were, as I just said, formed out of a collection of Germanic tribes who lived primarily along the Lower Rhine. Likely included among their number were the Batavians, who, you'll recall, revolted against Roman rule while the empire was occupied with the Year of the Four Emperors, the Chatti, who Domitian so successfully propagandized victories over, and elements of the Cherusci, the tribe Arminius had led to victory in the Teutoburg Forest. This new confederation was formed gradually over the years, as the various Germanic leaders realized that they were getting nowhere fighting amongst themselves. The new Frankish supergroup was by no means a unified whole at this point, and the various barbarian kings still exercised a great deal of autonomy. But this new spirit of Germanic cooperation would in time become one of the answers to the question, why did the West fall when it did? As long as Rome was able to keep the tribes politically and militarily fractured, they had very little to fear. But once they joined forces, well, let's just say that there's a reason we call France France and not Gaul. In 257, Valerian Gallienus and Valerian II all appear to have been in the modern city of Cologne, along the Lower Rhine, dealing with the sudden Frankish onslaught. Though the Franks were pushed back like all the other invaders of the mid-250s AD, at least one group kept moving forward and eventually crossed the Pyrenees into Spain, sacking the undefended coast towns of the deep interior. But with all three emperors posted on the Rhine, the rest of the empire began to slip quickly back into what was becoming its natural state, chaos. In the north, a Gothic tribe hit upon a novel idea that their compatriots would use to great effect in the years to come, constructing a fleet to carry them down the Black Sea coast on a raid of Asia Minor. With the Franks mostly contained, Valerian left Gallienus in charge of Gaul, while he himself headed east. But the emperor wound up having no time to pause on this new Gothic invasion, and instead replanted Valerian II as imperial figurehead along the Danube while he continued on to Syria. He was forced to keep moving because word had reached him that far from leaving well enough alone, Sharpur was attacking Roman territory with renewed vigor. The next 2 years get really tricky for historians trying to cobble together a chronological narrative, as Valerian chose this moment to revive Roman persecutions of the Christians, leading eventually to the death of Saint Cyprian, the Bishop of Carthage, in 258. Cyprian was a voluminous writer, and his collected correspondence has proved to be an invaluable resource to head to when we want to double-check when an event happened or whether it happened at all. Cyprian's writings act as a tiny little lighthouse in the distance, helping us navigate our way through the historical fog. But then the Romans went and killed him, leaving us with only random inscriptions, some coins, and gut instinct to lead us the rest of the way. So, thanks for that. There are three big things that happened during this two-year period that we have trouble dating and putting in order. The Battle of Edessa and Valerian's subsequent capture by the Sassanids, the death of his grandson Valerian II, and the revolt of Ingenus along the Danube. Some sources claim that Valerian II died of natural causes, and that when Ingenus heard that Valerian had been captured, he decided that the imperial family was now weak enough to revolt against. Others claim that the ambitious Ingenus decided to revolt simply because Gallienus and Valerian were both occupied elsewhere, that he killed Valerian II to kick off his campaign, and only later learned of Valerian's capture. Finally, we have the common version whereby it was the news of Valerian's capture that led Ingenus to kill Valerian II and revolt against Gallienus. I don't have a good answer for which of these versions is actually correct, and I don't think anyone else does either. But a consensus seems to have grown up around the idea that Valerian II died under suspicious circumstances in 258, right around the time news reached the Danube that Valerian had joined the Sassanids in battle. In this telling, it is the news of war in the east that got Ingenus' imagination running wild, rather than the news of the emperor's defeat. In this telling, there is a bit of a lag between the death of Valerian II and the official beginning of Ingenus' revolt, but that when the commander on the Danube did have himself declared emperor, that Gallienus rushed over from the Rhine to put down the revolt before word of his father's capture reached the west. This all leaves 260 AD as the watershed year when the empire really melted down, with news reaching Gallienus almost simultaneously that the Sassanids had captured his father and that his own withdrawal from the Rhine had triggered a new invasion by the Germans. The defeat of Valerian at Edessa in the east and the Germanic invasions in the west were, of course, the two events that led directly to the empire breaking into thirds, a state of affairs that would persist for more than a decade until Lucius Domitius Aurelianus, the unconquered restorer of the world, put the pieces back together again in the early 270s. To deal with poor Valerian first, we must follow the emperor east in 258 after dropping Valerian II off in Pannonia. The emperor probably passed through Antioch on his way to the city of Edessa in northern Mesopotamia, where he planned to stage his coming counteroffensive. But this counteroffensive would never really get off the ground, as a nasty bout of the Cyprian plague broke out amongst the legions in 259, and Valerian's forces were left thin and weak as a result. Sharpur decided to take advantage of the situation by marching on Edessa and challenging the emperor directly. Though we know very little about the details of the battle, it is reported that despite the toll taken on the legions, they still outnumbered the Sassanids by an almost 2-to-1 ratio, leaving Valerian confident that he would still be able to steamroll Sharpur's forces. But, for whatever reason, in the battle that commenced on the plains outside Edessa, the Romans were utterly routed, and practically the entire army Valerian had brought with him were either killed or captured. We don't know how exactly Valerian fell into Sharpur's custody, but the traditional Roman version has it that after the battle, Valerian arranged for a meeting with Sharpur to hammer out the terms of a settlement, and after arriving at the Sassanid court, the emperor was seized by the treacherous Persian king and taken prisoner. The alternative is that Valerian was simply tracked down during the battle and seized, making it easy to see why the Romans would prefer a version of events that allows the humiliating capture of their emperor to be painted as a result of a double cross, rather than trying to explain how an honorable Roman could have allowed himself to be taken alive. As with just about everything to do with this period, there are two versions of what happened next. The boring version is that Valerian and his senior officers were treated well by Sharpur and lived out the rest of their days as comfortable, if involuntary, guests of the Sassanids until the emperor's death in 264. The more salacious version is that the no-good wicked Persian king took every opportunity to humiliate the captured Valerian and used the Roman emperor daily as a stepping stool to get in and out of his royal litter. Then, when Valerian finally died, his body was flayed and stuffed and posted in the Persian court as a trophy for all of the East to mock and gloat over. Once again, it is easy to see why the Romans would prefer to paint the Sassanid king in the worst possible light. But barring a time machine, we'll never know the true fate of Valerian. We do know that he died in Persian custody, and that for a variety of reasons, no attempt was ever made to rescue him or pay a ransom for his return. He was in his mid-60s when he died, and had ruled the empire for 7 years. Those variety of reasons why nobody came looking for him had to do mostly with the fact that while the Eastern Empire was going to hell in a handbasket, the middle of the empire was going to hell in a handbasket, and the Western Empire was going to hell in a handbasket. In the final calculation, the life of one captured emperor was simply not worth the time and expense, not with so much hell being crammed into so many handbaskets. When news reached Gallienus that Ingenus was in revolt, he was forced to immediately withdraw a significant portion of the Rhine troops from the border to help him put down the rebellion. As he had previously done with Valerian II, Gallienus left his second son, Salonius, in Cologne as imperial figurehead under the protection of the commander, Marcus Cassianus Latinius Posthumus, and sped off to the Danube. Leading the suppression effort was a man who, at this point, Gallienus had supreme confidence in, but whose own ambitions would in time lead to his master's death, the general Aureolus. As commander of the imperial cavalry, Aureolus led the charge into Pannonia, where the sudden appearance of Gallienus' army took the wind out of Ingenus' sails, and the usurper either died in battle, was killed by his own troops, or committed suicide after realizing that his cause was hopeless. The upshot of all this, as I just mentioned, was that Gallienus' new position on the Danube led to a significant invasion of Germanic tribes along the Rhine. Along the lower portion of the river, the Franks poured across the frontier as Posthumus scrambled to hold them off with what forces he had been left with. Meanwhile, a huge group of Alemanni, a tribal super-confederation similar to the Franks operating along the Upper Rhine, poured through the under-garrisoned gap between the Danube and the Rhine, but rather than making for Gaul, as would have been expected, they instead decided to head directly into Italy. Obviously, this invasion of the home province was Gallienus' top priority. He ignored calls to go avenge his father in the east, who he just learned had been defeated and captured, reinforce Posthumus in the west, or stay put on the Danube and hold off the Goths. He chose instead to make with all haste to Milan in northern Italy, a city that, with Gallienus' help, was about to become one of the most important cities in the empire. The Alemanni crossed the Alps into Italy before Gallienus could get in their way, and they apparently raided all the way down to Rome itself before being turned back by a hastily raised militia. Not necessarily needing to embroil themselves in a prolonged siege of the imperial capital after having grabbed so much of northern Italy's wealth, the Alemanni turned around, but on their way back north they were met by Gallienus, who beat them decisively outside of Milan. One independent faction of the Germanic invaders escaped back through the Alps with their captured treasure, but the rest were stopped short, and those who survived the battle headed back home empty-handed. Though in the end it turned out to have no long-term ill effects, the invasion of the Alemanni was nonetheless a significant psychic blow to a population of Romans already dealing with a lot of bad news. But I guess that to say that the invasion had no long-term effects is misstating the case a bit. Yes, the invaders were beaten and driven off, but the time, energy, and manpower required to do so left every other region of the empire feeling like they had been abandoned by the emperor. In the east, the shattered legions were facing down a Sassanid army they could not hope to contain. In the west, Postumus was being overwhelmed by the Franks, and in the middle, a Danube army just weakened by the battle between Ingenuus and Gallienus stared across the river at a host of tribes itching to take advantage of the emperor's recent withdrawal to Italy. With each of these regions left on their own, the various legionary commanders had to take it upon themselves to organize and direct local defenses, leading their troops naturally to give their commanders a rank befitting men who were now wielding supreme authority over their respective provinces, Imperator. Rather than receiving congratulations from his generals then for having driven the Alemanni out of Italy, Gallienus spent the weeks after his victory instead receiving notes that each of them had been proclaimed emperor by their troops. On the eve of his battle with the Germans, Gallienus had ruled an empire that stretched from Gibraltar to the Euphrates and from the Sahara to Scotland. The next morning, he found himself barely in control of Italy. Next week, we will watch the empire split into thirds. Though Gallienus was able to reassert his dominion over the Balkans, he had neither the money nor the manpower to do much about the east or the west, and they quickly devolved into autonomous political territories of their own. But this was not all bad news for Gallienus and Rome. Postumus's Gallic Empire and the about-to-be-established Palmyrene Empire were far more concerned with repelling foreign invasion than they were with domestic squabbles, and it turns out that they were both so successful at fighting off the Germans and Sassanids respectively that it is hard to see how Gallienus himself could have ever done a better job. Ironically, the temporary breakup of the empire was perhaps one of the key reasons it was able to survive at all. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome, Episode 113, Three Empires. Though I haven't yet stated it explicitly, I think the nature of the military campaigns the Romans have lately been engaged in, against the Goths and the Sassanids and the Franks and the Alemanni, collectively speak for themselves. The Romans are now on the defensive. For its entire history, Rome had always projected outward. When battles were fought, they were fought in enemy territory. When battles were won, they enriched the empire with new wealth and new subjects. When battles were lost, it simply slowed the rate of Roman expansion. But now, the battles are being fought in Roman territory. When these battles are won, the reward is little more than a temporary peace. And far from enriching the empire, even victory was now a net loss on the balance sheet, in men, in money, in economic impact. And when those battles are lost, well, the very foundation of imperial legitimacy was the ability to provide physical security for its citizens. So, you do the math. In 260 AD, this legitimacy was finally shattered by simultaneous attacks on all the major frontiers. When the central government proved itself unable to provide the security demanded by its people, the people abandoned the central government, and the Roman Empire broke apart. Now, one thing that we should clear up right off the bat is that while the administrative reach of Gallienus's government is about to be radically reduced, at no point should the rise of the Gallic and Palmyrene empires be viewed as a repudiation of Roman values. Postumus's Gallic Empire may have seceded from the Union, as it were, but it did not reject the values, forms, or ideals that that union had been based upon. Right down to its Senate, annually elected consuls, and Praetorian Guard, the Gallic Empire was in every sense a Roman Empire, pursuing Roman policies in a Roman fashion. In the East, the career of Odenathus was at all times acknowledged as occurring within the established structure of the empire. He was, for all intents and purposes, leading an independent kingdom, but both he and Gallienus recognized the expediency of allowing Rome to officially bless the new leader of the East, to cloak Odenathus's actions behind a screen of imperial titles and offices to make it seem as if the two men were partners rather than rivals. Odenathus never pressed for the title of Augustus, and Gallienus never attempted to assert control over the East, and this was a state of affairs that suited both just fine for the time being. That is all to say that the 260s did not represent the rise of native independence movements. The decade represented instead an estrangement between the governing elites of the three regions, all of whom bought into the basic Roman political ideologies that had dominated the Mediterranean for the last few centuries. As I noted in the introduction, the underlying legitimacy crisis that faced the empire in the 260s was that the central government was no longer able to provide the kind of basic security its citizens had grown to expect. The myriad foreign invaders successfully overrunning the borders and sacking the provinces were not just running off with the empire's wealth, they were running off with the empire's raison d'etre. Whether or not there was a set of policies Gallienus could have pursued to create a more unified, centrally guided response to the invasions is interesting to think about, but ultimately irrelevant. He did not do so, and was very likely unable to do so. And it's not like he was fiddling while Rome burned. He was beating off an invasion of Italy itself when the political structure of the empire began to fracture. He was doing everything he could, but there was too much to do. To take the West first, you'll recall that when Gallienus headed to the Danube to put down the revolt of Ingenus, that he elevated his teenage son Solonius to the rank of Caesar, and left the defense of the western provinces in the hands of the eminently capable general Marcus Postumus. Postumus shared overall administrative authority with one of the Praetorian prefects who Gallienus had also left behind, a man by the name of Silvanus. Postumus and Silvanus divvied up responsibility for the region between them, with Silvanus running civilian affairs and looking after young Solonius, while Postumus controlled the army. And what an army it was. The ranks of the Rhine legions had already been thinned by the recent Frankish invasions, and Gallienus had now absconded with the cream of what was left to go off and fight in Genus. This put Postumus in a very tight spot, and put the troops remaining in Gaul on edge. How were they supposed to defend the entire frontier when they were this undermanned and this undersupplied? Into this atmosphere of fear and resentment stepped a fairly innocuous incident that would lead directly to the secession of the West. A raiding party of Germans was headed back towards the Rhine sometime in mid to late 260 when they were caught and defeated by Postumus. Well aware that he and the army he had been left with had been assigned a nearly impossible mission, Postumus decided to take the opportunity to reward his men and ordered that the captured wealth of the Germans be distributed amongst them. This endeared Postumus to his soldiers, but it did not endear him to the men who the wealth had been stolen from originally. When Silvanus heard about all this, he ordered Postumus to send the property he had recovered back from whence it had come. But Postumus refused the order. After all, didn't his men deserve something for risking their lives in defense of the provinces? When Silvanus refused to back down, Postumus and his army took the next logical step, logical in the context of the 3rd century anyway, and Postumus was acclaimed emperor. He then wheeled around and marched on Cologne, where he planned to force Silvanus and Solonius to submit to his authority. The young emperor and his guardian attempted to resist, but the far superior resources of Postumus allowed him to overcome the city defenses and capture his rivals. Well aware that there was no turning back now, Postumus likely executed Silvanus and Salonius and announced that he was taking over control of the Rhine. His agents spread the word, and in no time, replies came back from the governors of all three Spanish provinces, all three Gallic provinces, and the island of Britannia, supporting Postumus's claim to power. Their willingness to support Postumus was premised on his ability to halt the Germanic invasions that Emperor Gallienus had deemed not important enough to attend to personally. It was not that they did not appreciate Gallienus's presence when he was around, it was just that there was no counting on him to stick around. Twice already he had surveyed the empire and deemed the problems of the West not as important as the problems along the Danube or in Italy. And it's not even that they were arguing that the emperor could or should have done something different. It was just that, well, they couldn't go anywhere. Their homes and families and estates and clients were all stuck here. Whether or not the Frankish invasions were the worst problems the Romans faced was immaterial. When your house is on fire, you want someone to put it out. You don't want someone to tell you that some other, more important building is on fire and that they need to go put out that one first. Postumus was promising to never leave and to focus on putting out the fire along the Rhine, and so they supported him. This mandate, though, meant that unlike previous usurping generals, Postumus could not immediately pack up the army and march to Italy on a mission to overthrow Gallienus. Part of the reason why he was able to rule for a decade over half the empire, which puts his tenure in office amongst the longest of the whole century, by the way, was because he never forgot that his primary responsibility was to protect the West from invasion. By focusing on that limited objective, he was able to rule practically unopposed for 10 years. Right away, he reorganized the political order of the West and invited men of senatorial rank from the provinces loyal to him to meet in Gaul and form a new Senate, who would, like their new emperor, focus solely on the administration and safety of the West. No Gothic invasions would distract them. No Sassanid power plays would draw them away. It was time for the West to look out for itself. Gallienus, of course, was apoplectic. He had spent the majority of his years in office dealing with invasions along the Rhine, and had only abandoned the western frontier when a revolt had broken out along the Danube and when Germans had invaded the home province. What did they want from him? The empire was a big place, and to get all cranky because he couldn't provide them with his undivided attention 100% of the time was, in a word, childish. But as he sat in Milan mopping up after the Alemannic invasion, he quickly realized that as much as it burned him up, there was probably very little he could do right at that moment about Postumus. There was no doubt that as soon as he was able to, Gallienus was going to revenge himself upon Postumus. But right now, all those things that had drawn his attention away from the Rhine in the first place were still going on and still getting worse. When Gallienus looked at the big picture, the problems in the West were minor compared to the full-blown emergency that was currently marching across the Eastern Empire. Sharpur had taken his capture of Valerian as an invitation to sack as much of the Roman Empire as he could get his hands on, possibly with the idea of softening the region up for eventual annexation by the Sassanids. According to some sources, the defeat at Edessa had cost the Romans something like 70,000 men. And though a great deal of those had been brought west by Valerian, the eastern legions were still a pale shadow of their former selves. And they had very little hope of reinforcement, as what imperial forces were available had been mustered by Gallienus to defend Italy. But all was not lost. As the Sassanids crashed into Syria, two Roman officials stepped forward to organize a defense. The first was a general named Ballista, or possibly Callistus, depending on what source you read, who took over the remnants of the legions and organized a pseudo-guerrilla campaign to harass Sharpur's supply lines, pick off isolated detachments, and generally make life frustrating for the invading Sassanids. The other official was one of Valerian's chief financial officers, a man named Fulvius Macrianus, who had been left behind in Antioch, along with the traveling imperial treasury, when Valerian had marched forward to Edessa. With Ballista's help, Macrianus was able to keep the treasury out of Sharpur's hands and use it to fund the effort to expel the Sassanids from Roman territory. For the rest of the year, the two men did everything they could to halt Sharpur, and though they slowed him down, they were unable to prevent him from marching into Asia Minor on a campaign that Sharpur's own propaganda claimed led to the sacking of 36 Roman cities. By the end of the year, though, constant harassment and the fatigue of his own men led Sharpur to opt for withdrawal back to Sassanid territory. Laden with captured slaves and treasure, the Sassanid king was feeling pretty good about himself, and likely thinking that the next time he marched west, he might just make a play at staying permanently. Which brings us to Lucius Septimius Odenathus and the city of Palmyra. Palmyra was an oasis town located in the deserts between Persia and Syria, and it served as a key link in the east-west trade routes, acting as the last way station on the northern leg of the Silk Road. Not only did the city's isolated location allow it to grow wealthy from the duties and taxes levied on traders who had no other option but to pass through Palmyra, but it also allowed them to run a protection racket, supplying local muscle to help ward off desert thieves who might set upon an unprotected caravan. That there was something of a revolving door between the desert thieves and the local muscle is, of course, neither here nor there. Palmyra's location out in the middle of the desert also allowed it something that most cities in the ancient world had long since lost: independence. The age of the city-state had long ago given way to the age of the multinational empire. But Palmyra lay out in a nebulous gray area between Rome to the west and Persia to the east. As such, it was often claimed by both, but controlled by neither. As Parthian power had waned, though, Palmyra had more and more come into the Roman sphere, and many of its leading citizens had also been made Roman citizens. Emperors understood the economic importance of the oasis city and wanted to make sure that the rulers of Palmyra were given every privilege and perk of status enjoyed by the leading men of Rome. As his name suggests, the family of Lucius Septimius Odenathus had been granted citizenship by Septimius Severus around the turn of the 3rd century, and though they were not technically Roman senators, they were recognized as being of senatorial rank in the economic sense of the term, if not in the strictly political sense. By the 250s, Odenathus was the leading man of Palmyra and acting as the city's chief executive. He had close ties to Rome, but the growing power of the Sassanids had left him and his city in a precarious position. The Romans were content to let Palmyra enjoy its nominal independence as long as the trade routes continued to function and the taxes on Roman merchants didn't get out of hand. But Sharpur seemed an altogether more ambitious sort. Odenathus had been worried for some time that the Sassanids would attempt to take over direct control of Palmyra, and with the Romans being dealt several defeats in a row at the hands of the Persians, his anxiety had to have grown immeasurably by the time Valerian was captured in 260. Some sources claim Odenathus made overtures to Sharpur, attempting to forge an eastern-looking alliance, but that the Sassanid king had rejected the notion of a treaty, clearly indicating that a takeover of Palmyra was coming down the chute. But others reject the notion that Odenathus made any attempt to bargain with the Sassanids, and that from the get-go, he believed that the fortunes of his city were best served when they were tied to the fortunes of Rome. Whatever the underlying reasons, when Sharpur made his way back to the east in 260 laden with treasure, he was met by an army raised and led by the Palmyrene prince. The result of the meeting was a complete rout of the unprepared Sassanid army. Sharpur thought himself 1,000 miles from anything resembling a real threat, and was as surprised as his men to find himself suddenly fleeing back to Ctesiphon after being smacked around by some cobbled-together army led by an obscure Palmyrene. By putting Sharpur to flight, though, obscure Odin office vanished forever, replaced in the minds of East and West alike by legendary Odin office. Legendary Odin office went on to become one of the most unique figures in Roman history. His capital was Palmyra, technically beyond the Roman frontier. And though he held Roman citizenship, he was still considered by most Romans to be a barbarian. A smart barbarian and a cultured barbarian, but a barbarian nonetheless. There is always something to be said for promoting men of merit wherever you can find them. And any time the Romans faced a dire crisis, they always did well when they laid down their traditional class biases to elevate the most capable man to lead them out of the danger, whoever he might be and wherever he might come from. But the rank, power, and status gained by Odenathus was something altogether different. After defeating the Sassanids, this foreigner essentially leased the eastern provinces from its Roman owners. He never held the title, but he lived in the house, and he called the shots, all with Gallienus' technical blessing. Were he not viewed as the only thing standing between the Romans and a complete Sassanid takeover, nothing even remotely close to this arrangement would have been possible, and Odenathus probably would have been executed for even suggesting it. But desperate times call for desperate measures, and in these desperate times, the Romans gave themselves over to a Palmyrene prince who promised to keep the Persians at bay. As the West was giving itself over to Posthumus, and the East was giving itself over to Odenathus, there was one other trouble spot that Gallienus faced after his defeat of the Alemanni in 260 AD. Back on the northern frontier, the troops that had been left behind after Gallienus headed to Italy following his suppression of Ingenus were dealing with a host of German tribes ready, willing, and able to overrun the Danube. As was the case with the Rhine legions, the Danube troops resented the emperor for dashing off after deeming their problems not sufficiently dire enough to remain in country with them. Again, their resentment may not have been rational. The emperor was, after all, going to defend Italy, the home province, the invasion of which probably was the most dire threat facing the empire at that particular moment. But that didn't stop them from taking the emperor's absence personally, and as they steeled themselves to fend off the Germans, they elevated one of their generals, a man named Regillianus, to the rank of emperor. As with Posthumus, the elevation was not taken by Regillianus as his cue to march on Rome and establish his authority over the capital. Instead, he took it as his cue to lead a vigorous defense of the Danube provinces, which he now considered his personal responsibility. So, there were now at least three men, Gallienus, Posthumus, and Regillianus, each claiming the title imperator. And it is possible that they were already joined by two more, the sons of Macrianus in the east. It is hard to tell when in this mishmash of events Quietus and Macrianus the Younger were elevated to the rank of co-Augusti by the eastern legions at the behest of their father, but it probably came not long after Odenathus's victory over Sharpur. It is not hyperbole to state that at this moment, the empire's executive leadership had never been as fractured, as local citizens and soldiers alike each looked to local commanders to see them through these dangerous times. In Italy, Gallienus still considered himself the ultimate master of the whole empire, and while his rivals focused on defending the borders, Gallienus focused on how to win back all that had so suddenly been stolen from him. Though the East and West would remain outside of his jurisdiction for the rest of his life, the Danube provinces were quickly brought back into the fold, as Regillianus was killed shortly after his elevation, battling a tribe of invading Germans. Gallienus immediately marched up from Italy to restore his mastery over the legion, and with the emperor on hand once again, the legions quickly fell back into line. One of the biggest problems facing Gallienus at this point was that events were unfolding so fast, and invasions occurring over such a wide area, that it was difficult to deploy legionary forces in a timely manner. For all his rushing about, Gallienus always seemed to be arriving too late to nip problems in the bud, and seemed to forever be showing up just in time to close the barn door after the horses had run off. This inability to efficiently reinforce hotspots was not just increasing the amount of devastation being wrought on the provinces, but, as we've just seen, it was also leading to an exponential increase in the number of usurpers challenging his rule. But if the provincial legions could be convinced that the emperor would be able to quickly provide help when they were attacked, Gallienus figured they would be less prone to supporting rivals. Right now, though, the legionary apparatus was too cumbersome to move quickly from one zone to another. So Gallienus hit upon an idea that, though it would not become official Roman policy for another generation, it would one day become a staple of Roman defenses in the 4th century. The mobile cavalry. Up until this point, cavalry units were attached to infantry legions, and they would all move around and fight together. But as quickly as the Roman legions could move, a couple of thousand foot soldiers are never going to be able to move as fast as a couple of thousand horsemen. What Gallienus did was collect all the various cavalry detachments and mass them together into a single force that would be run by a single commander and be answerable directly to the emperor. From this point on, wherever there was trouble, the emperor would order his mass cavalry unit to the scene, and in many cases, their mere presence would be enough to deter invaders. And not only did this cavalry serve as an excellent deterrent, it also served as a good psychological connection between the far-flung provincial legions and their emperor. They no longer felt they were being left to fend for themselves out on the frontier. Maybe the mobile cavalry wasn't based in their territory, but when they needed help, help was on the way. Gallienus strategically based this new force in the city of Milan, where they could keep an eye not just on Postumus, whose long-term ambitions were at this point unknown, but also on any Germans thinking about crossing through the Alps into Italy. They were also near enough the Danube frontier that if the Goths got itchy feet, and they would over the next decade, the mobile cavalry could spring into action and be on the scene in no time. It was an idea born of the particular circumstances Gallienus was facing at the time, with domestic revolts and foreign invasions cropping up all around him. But in time, the wisdom of a permanent mobile defense force would become obvious. Times had changed. Simply posting legionary garrisons along the frontier was no longer sufficient to ward off foreign threats to the empire. There are many reasons why Gallienus's reign is seen as a period of transition, and the mobile cavalry is just one obvious example. Next week, we'll get into a few more examples. In particular, Gallienus's relationship with the Senate and the growing divide between a political career and a military career would lead to the armed forces finally becoming a completely separate branch of the state. Rome had always intermingled its political leaders with its military leaders, and indeed, the most important function of the consul had, once upon a time, been to act as the commander-in-chief of the army. The days of combining military and civilian careers, though, was about to end, as the professionalization of the army, long established among the rank and file, was now finally reaching to the top of the chain of command. Henceforth, generals would now be generals, and politicians would be politicians, and only in the person of the emperor would they ever meet again. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome. Episode 114, The Nadir of Our Fortunes. Last time, we left Rome in a state of disrepair. The East had been invaded by the Sassanids. The Danube had been invaded by the Goths. Italy had been invaded by the Alemanni, and the West had been invaded by the Franks. Unable to handle all of these foreign threats at once, and still reeling from the capture of his father, Gallienus watched helplessly as the legions across the empire elevated their own local commanders to the purple, breaking the empire into pieces. The son of Valerian would never again rule a united empire, though he would spend the rest of his life vainly pursuing the dream of reunification. Though we know that the East eventually fell into the hands of Odenathus and his wife Zenobia, when all the trouble began in 260, it actually looked like ex-treasury official Macrianus would be the man calling the shots in Antioch. You'll recall from last time that Macrianus and the general Ballista had organized a resistance to the Sassanid invasion following Valerian's capture, and when the Persians were finally pushed out, the Eastern legions naturally looked to the man with the money to continue leading them. Ballista seems to have been content to support Macrianus rather than compete with him, and so Macrianus became the dominant Roman official east of the Hellespont. But for some reason, possibly because he was a cripple, though I'm not entirely sure that that's accurate, Macrianus did not himself assume the imperial dignities. Instead, he induced the legions to elevate to the purple his two grown sons, Quietus and Macrianus the Younger. The two men were dutifully hailed as Augustus, following in the footsteps of the Rhine legions and the Danube legions, who had elevated Posthumus and Regalianus respectively. But unlike these other two competing Augusti, the Macrianae family had no intention of staying put in the east and simply keeping an eye on the Sassanids. Macrianus did not want to just defend Syria. He wanted to formally oust Gallienus and capture the whole empire for himself. In pursuit of this goal, he and his son Macrianus the Younger packed up 30,000 troops and marched them west to confront Gallienus. Now, those numbers are likely exaggerated, but still, after the catastrophic losses suffered at Edessa, the removal of any soldiers at all had to have dangerously weakened the frontier defenses. I would like to say that the fact that the Macrianae are about to get stomped into the ground by Gallienus is somehow divine retribution for leaving the East so undermanned. But Regalianus did right by the Danube, defending the empire rather than trying to capture it, and he died too. So, unfortunately, it seems that blind fate rather than karmic justice was doing the yeoman's work throughout the 260s AD. Macrianus had left his son Quietus in charge at Antioch while he and Macrianus the Younger marched on Italy in 261. They only made it as far as the Balkans, though, where they were met and defeated in battle by an army led by Gallienus' top general, Aureolus. Both Macrianae were killed in the battle, but, perhaps more importantly, the battle cost the lives of way more troops than the empire could afford to lose. Things in the east probably would have spiraled out of control had not Odenathus and Palmyra picked up the slack Macrianus had left behind. Leading a motley army composed of various eastern auxiliaries, his own Palmyrene heavy cavalry, and probably what was left of Valerian's legionary forces, Odenathus patrolled the border with vigor and kept Sharpur's imagination from drifting back to visions of conquest. Of critical importance to his own future career, Odenathus did not throw his lot in with the Macrianae and chose instead to remain loyal to the government of Rome. That did not mean that he went out of his way to defend the honor of Gallienus when the Syrian legions declared Macrianus the Younger and Quietus their new Augusti, but it did mean that when word came back that Gallienus had successfully fended off their challenge, that Odenathus took the opportunity to display his fidelity to the true emperor. The army he led far outshone anything left in the hands of Quietus and Ballista, and after camping his imposing forces outside Antioch, Odenathus ordered that Quietus be captured and executed. No one knows what happened to Ballista, as he simply disappears from the historical record without a trace around this same time, but the presumption is that he too was killed by either Odenathus or some other officer loyal to Rome. The rise and fall of the Macrianae left the East, by default, in the hands of Odoacer. He held Roman citizenship and had obviously been a loyal ally, but he was seen by practically everyone as an outsider. After all, he did hail from a city beyond the frontier. But for the moment at least, the citizens of the East had very little time to indulge in prejudices. Odoacer was there, leading an army in defense of the empire. Who cared where he came from? Gallienus himself certainly did not seem to care much about Odoacer's origins, or, at this point, what his ultimate intentions may be. Unable to spare any resources to reinforce the East, let alone reassert his full control over it, Gallienus was, for the time being, willing to cede Odoacer's dominion over the East, as long as the Palmyrene prince remained loyal to Gallienus and focused his attention on the Sassanids, rather than on accruing more territory for himself within the empire. These terms were amenable to Odoacer, and from 262 until his death in 267 or 268, the Palmyrene prince was the de facto ruler of the Eastern Empire. He was given the title Imperator, in the old military sense of the term, rather than the more recent political meaning. But, as was the long-standing custom, the victories of the Palmyrene were technically credited to Gallienus, a subtle piece of propaganda which helped maintain the appearance of subordination on the part of Odoacer. Perhaps betraying his long-term goals, though, shortly after rising to power, Odoacer began styling himself as the King of Kings, just as would a traditional Eastern monarch. In most ways, the rise of Odoacer had very little effect on how the East functioned. It appears that the legionary garrisons were kept mostly intact, and that the commanders were for the most part left in place. The various municipal governments kept running just as they always had, and the lives of the citizens changed not at all. This is all to say that Odoacer ruled with a very light hand. There were no dramatic purges and no mass firings. The only time he really exercised his power was when he acted as the arbitrator of last resort, settling legal disputes or making the final decision on some infrastructure project. Other than that, he did indeed keep his attention focused squarely on the task of defending the provinces from attack. Indeed, the one major difference between life before Odoacer and life after Odoacer was the existence of this huge independent army roving around the deserts, weaving in and out of Sassanid territory, attacking when necessary and defending when necessary. This army was both the reason why Syria was not captured by Sharpur and the reason why Gallienus stayed on the west side of the Hellespont. It was an efficient, disciplined, and highly mobile force. Over the course of the 260s, Odoacer did not just keep the Sassanids at bay, but he also pushed east and reasserted Roman dominion over territory that Sharpur had annexed during the course of the past decade. There is a reason Odoacer receives near universal praise in the ancient histories, and it's because he seemed to be some quasi-divine savior sent by the gods to rescue the Eastern Empire at its darkest hour. With the Eastern question more or less settled, and the middle provinces back under his control following the death of Regalianus, the West now loomed as the last big finger pointing Gallienus and Rome in the eye. Where Odoacer had diplomatically parlayed his position into one that bore the imperial seal of approval, Posthumus ruled in direct competition to Gallienus. Where the Eastern provinces still recognized the overall legitimacy of the Roman emperor, and critically, the mint in Antioch still coined in Gallienus' name, the West had gone over to Posthumus completely. The Gallic mint coined for Posthumus and celebrated his role as the protector of the West. This was an affront that Gallienus could not tolerate. There is, as with so much else to do with this period, some controversy over the date or dates of Gallienus' attempt to reconquer the Western provinces. Some claim that there were two attempts, one in 261 in the immediate aftermath of Posthumus' revolt, and another, more concerted effort in 266. Others claim that there was just one attempt, and that it occurred sometime between 263 and 265. Despite the confusion of the dating, though, the outcome remains the same. Gallienus was able to establish a permanent beachhead on the far side of the Alps, but he was unable to decisively defeat Postumus and reunite the empire. As usual, the man leading the attack for Gallienus was Aureolus, the captain of the cavalry. Starting from their headquarters in Milan, the imperial army marched up through the Alps and crossed over into Gaul on their way to the capital of Gallia Belgica, which also served as the capital of Postumus's Gallic Empire. Postumus had been made aware of the invasion by spies in Gallienus's camp, and was ready when the army led by Aureolus finally appeared. In the battles that followed, though, there is one clear fact that the ancient sources point out again and again. Postumus was beaten by Aureolus, but that, for whatever reason, Aureolus did not press his advantage, capture his enemy, or crush his enemy's army. Though there could have been any number of good reasons for his failure to deal a killing stroke, like that maybe his victories were not as complete as we have been led to believe, the consensus among the Romans was that Aureolus had made a secret pact with Postumus. In this telling, Aureolus was already planning to eventually revolt against his master, and was looking for Postumus' support when it came time to make his bid. If there was a deal, it wasn't a very good one for Aureolus. When, in 267, he finally did make his bid for the throne, his calls to Postumus went unanswered. But we're getting ahead of ourselves. Gallienus probably would have kept right on going despite these missed opportunities, had he not been shot with an arrow and forced to withdraw to seek medical attention. This brought on what Gallienus thought would be only a temporary halt to his campaign, but in fact, it would bring an end to his attempts to reconquer the West. As I just mentioned, some scholars think there were two invasions, the first ending with Aureolus' failure to capture Postumus, and the second ending with Gallienus' injury. But most seem to think that it was all wrapped up in a single short war. The campaign was not a total failure, though. When Gallienus temporarily ceased hostilities, he had won back firm control of the Gallic territory abutting the Alps, meaning that the emperor controlled both ends of the key mountain passes in and out of Italy. Just as Gallienus would never recapture the West, Postumus would never again have access to the Alps. This is the map that both men would bequeath to their successors, and eventually be the map from which Aurelian launched his own successful campaign to reunify the empire in 274. While Gallienus had lost control of the east and the west, he was still in control of the middle of the empire, and was not so consumed with foreign wars and internal squabbles that he failed to make his mark on the development of Rome. Well, actually, maybe it was because of all the foreign wars and internal squabbles that Gallienus wound up leaving his mark on Rome. The ancient sources uniformly dismiss Gallienus' reign as the absolute low point of the empire's history. He is often portrayed as indifferent to the fact that two-thirds of the empire had slipped away from him, and that he was far more interested in pursuing the perks and pleasures that came with being emperor than he was with fighting for what was Rome's. Highlighting the general content with Gallienus' rule is the myth of the so-called 30 tyrants. That is, the long list of men who rose up in revolt against Gallienus during his reign. Odenathus and Postumus and Macrianus and Regalianus are all on the list, as is the prefect of Egypt, Emilianus, who revolted in 262, and the commander of the garrison at Byzantium, who revolted around the same time. Even Gibbon is quick to point out that the 30 tyrants is a transparent piece of rhetoric, referencing the old 30 tyrants of Athens, the post-war government installed by Sparta at the end of the Peloponnesian War. And the list of usurpers offered by the Historia Augusta has been thoroughly debunked, with most of the men listed having never assumed imperial dignity or having never existed at all. Despite the exaggerations, though, there is no doubt that the sheer number of men challenging Gallienus' rule during the 260s, however many there actually were, points to near uniform disenchantment with his administration. Or does it? As we've mentioned elsewhere, the histories relied upon to establish narrative continuity for all our archaeological evidence were written by men of senatorial rank for men of senatorial rank, and the biases of that class dominate the portrayals of the various emperors. The Senate had no love whatsoever for Gallienus, as he famously delivered a major blow to their power and prestige. During the reign of Gallienus, the Senate was once and for all excluded from having anything to do with military affairs. Now, it is interesting to note two things about this development. One, despite claims to the contrary, it does not seem that Gallienus issued some dramatic decree banning senators from serving in the army. And two, that nothing he did was in any way a radical departure from the policies followed by Marcus Aurelius during the Marcomannic Wars. Gallienus's problem, as had been Marcus's problem, was that the situation was so critical that there was very little margin for error. Bringing in some rich, inexperienced aristocrat to run a legion in the middle of a war zone, simply because that was the way things had always been done, was a really good way to get that legion wiped out. Marcus had responded by elevating capable, experienced soldiers like Pertinax, Pompeianus, Pescennius Niger, and Maximianus, none of whom were of senatorial rank, rather than turning to self-entitled senators. Gallienus too followed this policy, and the men he turned to lead his armies were all career military men who would in time go on to return the empire to something resembling its former glory, including Claudius Gothicus, Aurelian, and a young Probus. None of these men were of senatorial rank or aristocrats in any sense of the word, but they knew soldiering, and Gallienus trusted them, and that was all that mattered. And in the long run, it was probably better for Rome. As Gallienus shut out inexperienced senators from military postings, young, ambitious aristocrats were unable to gain even basic military experience, creating a feedback loop which led Gallienus and his successors to completely ignore the senatorial class from now on when looking to fill out the officer corps. Gallienus also introduced a subtle shift in the way that provinces were governed that further calcified the division between civilian and military leadership. The rank of legate, that is, the leader of a single legion, was rebranded as the legatus equitis, and now made unavailable as an office to a senator, reserved instead for career military men of equestrian rank. Senators were still duly appointed as governors of the provinces, but the legions of the provinces were put in the hands of men who knew what they were doing. In provinces where there was only a single legion, a situation that traditionally led the governor to double as that legion's legate, well, those were transformed into equestrian prefectures, a model invented by Augustus when he was trying to figure out how to maintain personal control over Egypt without having to worry about senatorial interference. All of these affronts to their dignity, whether they were justified or not, really rubbed the Senate the wrong way. And when the empire successfully emerged into the 4th century, the history of the 3rd century began to be reworked by conservative members of the senatorial class into a series of morality plays that had a clear cast of heroes and villains, with emperors like Claudius, Tacitus, and even Aemilianus painted as paradigms of republican virtue, while Gallus, Gallienus, and Aurelian were painted as cruel, lazy, or ineffectual, depending on the man. The Historia Augusta, for example, expends a great deal of ink praising Postumus, who was, after all, nothing less than a traitor to Rome, in order to contrast him with the terrible, no-good Gallienus. Odenathus, as I've already mentioned, received similar glowing treatment. This is not to take away from the accomplishments of Postumus and Odenathus, but it is interesting to note how much praise is heaped on the two men who did the most to divide the empire because of the Senate's lingering hatred for Gallienus. Despite this friction with the upper classes, Gallienus did manage to stay in power for 15 years, so he had to be doing something right. After the tumultuous years following the capture of his father, one of the main lessons the emperor took away was that if he was going to maintain his tenuous hold on the Middle Empire, and perhaps one day win back the East and the West, he was going to have to do a better job making sure that the army still under his command remained loyal to him and did not jump to their local generals every time someone said boo. Now, it was not exactly a mystery how you kept soldiers in the 3rd century loyal to you, and Gallienus was no dummy. Thus, one of his lasting legacies was the founding of multiple mints across the empire. Up until this point, besides the main mint in Rome, there were only a few major coining centers in the provinces, making transporting soldier pay and promised bonuses both time-consuming and dangerous. So Gallienus founded at least 4 new mints near all the major military headquarters in northern Italy and along the Danube, which kept the soldiers paid in full and on time, and left them, as you can imagine, extremely well disposed towards their emperor. The downside of this increase in mints, though, was that it sped up a process that the Romans did not understand at all, but that we today are well acquainted with and very watchful of: inflation. Now, like most of you, I learned about inflation from the classic DuckTales episode Do Re Mi, when Huey, Dewey, and Louie got their hands on a duplicating ray and used it to duplicate some money so they could have enough to go buy a new bike. But of course, the duplicating ray had a glitch. Anything that gets duplicated will spontaneously duplicate itself after a brief period of time. Pretty soon, Duckburg was swimming in duplicated cash, lollipops cost a wheelbarrow full of coins, and the price of the new bike that had started all this had increased 100-fold. Uncle Scrooge was, of course, wiped out, as the coins he had so carefully hoarded in his money bin were now all worthless. Not a pretty sight. So, first of all, don't tell me that silly anthropomorphic cartoons have no educational value. And second, that this is exactly what happened to the Roman Empire as revenue failed to meet expenditures during the 3rd century. The imperial reaction was to simply produce more money so that they could pay off all their debts, leading to spiraling prices, savings being wiped out, and a reversion, eventually, back to primitive barter and payments in kind. Adding to these economic woes, that in the 260s were still looming on the horizon, was the fact that with the imperial mines running dry, and no new sources of silver and gold anywhere to be found, the emperors were forced to debase the coinage to keep up with the increased rate of production. Debasement was, of course, nothing new, but the process had thus far been pretty gradual, and the market had been given time to adjust. In the 200 years from Augustus to Septimius Severus, the standard denarius had declined its silver content from 98% to just about 50%. In the 50 years since the death of Severus, though, the silver content plummeted to just 1.5%. 1.5. This was a silver ratio so low that the denarius literally no longer resembled itself. The various emperors had done all of this in secret, of course, because, while they may not have understood inflation, they certainly understood the dangerous ramifications of making their coins intrinsically less valuable. But it did not take long for people to catch on. Despite multiple imperial declarations stating that all coins should be accepted at face value, savvy merchants of the 3rd century began adjusting their prices by the weight of their customers' coins rather than simply counting the number of them. But as I just said, it took a little while for the effects of all these monetary shenanigans to be felt, and Gallienus mostly benefited from his printing of more money, despite the fact that it was bad money. As I mentioned a few times previously, coins in the Roman Empire were a primary vehicle of imperial propaganda, and with each new batch of coins flooding out into the provinces, the citizens of the empire became awash not just in cash, but with the persistent drumbeat message that everything was fine, everyone was getting along, the empire was safe, the armies were happy, and the emperor was on the case. There were, of course, outward signs that all of this was perhaps not as true as the emperor would like it to be, but one rule of mass media is that if you repeat something enough times, a lot of people are going to start believing it. Gallienus repeated himself a lot, and with no opposing media outlets contradicting him, many citizens simply shrugged their shoulders and believed him. The 260s AD are often represented as the nadir of Roman fortunes. The empire was divided from itself, and men were rising up in revolt almost daily against an ineffectual emperor who seemed content to let it all burn. But this is an oversimplification, an exaggeration, and, bluntly, untrue. Gallienus, like Domitian before him, has been absolutely vilified. But when we look back with a more sober eye on the period, we find that he was not at all ineffectual, that he vigorously and actively defended the empire from foreign invasion and attempted to put the broken pieces of Roman society back together. He did indeed preside over a divided empire, but with everything Rome was facing, the temporary division probably wound up profiting the empire in the end. What did not profit the empire was Gallienus' monetary policies, which came back to haunt Rome in a big way. But even in this, it's not like Gallienus invented debasement or the overcoining of money. The son of Valerian was certainly not the best emperor. Indeed, he was about to be shown by Aurelian what a really good emperor can do when he puts his mind to something. But he certainly wasn't one of the worst either. Next week, we will get to the fall of this not great but not terrible emperor. Either by coincidence or fate, the death of Gallienus was matched almost simultaneously by the death of Postumus in the west and Odenathus in the east. Within the span of a single year, the three men who had dominated the lives of Romans everywhere were dead, leaving power vacuums in all three corners of the empire. While the west would fall into the hands of unworthy successors, the east would be claimed by the wife of Odenathus, the Palmyrene queen Zenobia, who would in time prove to be her husband's equal in every way. And had she not run up against Aurelian, it is very possible that she would have emerged as his better in every way. Hello, and welcome to the History of Rome. Episode 115, Phase 2 complete. As the 260s drew to a close, the political order of the Roman Empire had begun to settle a bit. Postumus was in charge of the West, administering the provinces in Gaul and Hispania and Britain, while out in the East, Odenathus had carved out a sphere of influence for himself that kept the citizens of Syria, Palestine, and Asia Minor free from worries about another Sassanid invasion. Probably steaming about the loss of influence on the outer rims of his empire, Gallienus, nonetheless, dedicated himself to the governance of the Middle Empire, and in addition to fending off the Goths, he tried to strengthen the internal economy and even promote some of the long-neglected arts and sciences. After so much chaos and uncertainty and violence, a new equilibrium had been achieved. It was not a perfect equilibrium. After all, none of the external menaces to the empire had been vanquished. They had just been temporarily stalled. And the empire itself, well, there were now three of them, weren't there? Not that it mattered. The new equilibrium is about to be shattered. It was out in the east that the balance first began to slip. Odenathus, like a latter-day Alexander or Caesar, had come out of nowhere with a personality so strong and a skill set so superior to his contemporaries that it was almost like he was playing on a different level than everyone else. It is not hyperbole to say that following the capture of Valerian in 260, the Eastern Empire stood on the brink of permanent occupation. Maybe the still immense resources of the Roman Empire would have fended off the Sassanids, but those resources had been halved by the breakaway of the western provinces, and the rest were being spent on the defense of the Danube. There seemed to be nothing standing in the Persians' way. Sure, Macrianus and Ballista had run a fairly successful guerrilla defense, but was there anything anyone could put in the field to actually beat Sharpur in battle? The answer, as it turned out, was yes, and the answer was Odenathus. Right when it seemed like the end was nigh, the Palmyrene prince had swept in, and not only delivered a decisive victory against the Sassanid army, but he held them at bay for the next 7 years, just when moments before it seemed that there was nothing that could even trip Sharpur up, let alone keep him home. Odenathus was, during the 260s, the indispensable man in the Eastern Empire. Without him, all would be lost. But of course, you know what de Gaulle said about indispensable men. The backdrop for the final chapter of the life of Odenathus was the 267 invasion of the Roman Empire by the Goths. In successive waves, they began pouring south by land and by sea, and no one seemed able to stop them. Thus far, Odenathus had naturally focused his attention on the east, as the Sassanids were his main concern. But seaborne Goths were now harrying the Black Sea coast of Asia Minor and threatening the lands beyond the Taurus Mountains, which Odenathus considered part of his mandate. So, for the first time, he began making preparations to leave the eastern front and head north to face the Goths. But he never would get to face them. The indispensable man of the east did not die in battle or succumb to plague or go out in a blaze of glory. Instead, it seems that he fell victim to an assassin who was inspired mostly by a personal humiliation. The story that's most commonly related is that while off on a hunt with his royal entourage, Odenathus's nephew breached some bit of protocol. Maybe he took the first shot at something, or maybe he refused to allow some prized target to be taken by his uncle. Whatever he did, he was subsequently either chastised in too harsh of terms publicly, or possibly put in some kind of timeout when the party returned home. Whatever his offense and whatever his punishment, it all led the nephew to burn with resentment, and at a family celebration a short time later, the nephew, probably by way of poison, killed Odenathus and his eldest son. The nephew's role in the sudden and shocking death of the Lord of Palmyra was soon discovered, and he was put to death by Odenathus's now widow, Zenobia. A variation of the story has it that Zenobia herself was behind the murder so that her son Vibolithus would have a clear path to power. In this telling, the older son who died along with Odenathus was from Odenathus's previous marriage and was thus standing between Vibolithus and the throne. Given the fact that this follows the familiar wicked stepmother trope that the Romans so loved, modern historians typically discount this version. Another version has it that Gallienus instigated the murder because he feared the growing power of Palmyra. But this too is usually dismissed for a number of different reasons, the main one being that the death of the protector of the East opened up Gallienus's flank to the Sassanids right at the moment when he was preparing to go fight a major campaign against the Goths. Maybe if the murder had occurred when there was less imminent danger to the empire, we could indulge in that particular conspiracy theory. But really, Gallienus killing Odenathus at that moment would have been the height of folly. In the immediate aftermath of Odenathus' death, there was a great deal of confusion about who was now in charge. Odenathus' authority had been a personally held grant from Gallienus. So, did power now devolve back to the Roman governors, or did Odenathus' son inherit his father's titles? With everyone just kind of looking at everyone else, Zenobia stepped forward and simply acted as if her husband's death meant that of course Vibolithus would inherit all the power ceded to the family by Gallienus. But of course, since Vibolithus was still a young child, Zenobia herself would have to act as regent, which means that unless you have a mind to stop me, I am now in charge around here. With shrewd political sensibilities, and the backing of one of her husband's top generals, an experienced soldier named Zabdis, Zenobia was able to assume all the powers Odenathus had claimed before any other rival could even muster a counterclaim. Tied up on the Danube with the Gothic invasion, Gallienus couldn't spare the time or attention it would take to weigh in on the subject. He did send a trusted lieutenant east to make sure that the queen understood who was really in charge, but, signaling who she thought was really in charge, the emissary was treated with less dignity than a man of his rank would have expected, and he soon packed up and left in an angry huff over Zenobia's calculated haughtiness. This snubbing of Gallienus's men would eventually reveal itself to be the first step in Zenobia's long-term plan to establish a hold on what was slowly turning from the Eastern Roman Empire into the new independent Palmyrene Empire. As I just mentioned, though, Gallienus was too caught up with his own problems to deal with Zenobia's power play. Those problems were the same problems that Odenathus had been gearing up to face when he died: the massive Gothic invasion of 267. After watching some of their brothers achieve great success using a small fleet to pillage the Black Sea coast, a collection of Gothic tribes decided that what had worked on a small scale would work even better on a large scale. So they built or commandeered some 500 ships, and in early 267, they set sail south from the estuary of the Dniester River without much more of a plan than to see what came along and then take it. They made their way down the west coast of the Black Sea and decided that they hadn't quite had their fill yet, so they passed into the Bosphorus with an eye on taking Byzantium. When the city proved to be a tougher nut to crack than they had hoped, though according to some sources they did indeed crack the nut eventually, they continued south through the Sea of Marmara and then made an attempt on the city of Cyzicus. Gallienus and the Romans were not sitting around idly as this Gothic fleet sacked the coastal cities of the empire, and the imperial navy based in Ravenna was launched on a mission to sink the invading barbarians. The Roman navy caught the Goths as they were occupied with Cyzicus, and the Goths, not being the best sailors in the world, were scattered by the much more competent Roman sailors. Though the naval battle in the Sea of Marmara was a decisive Roman victory, a sizable collection of Gothic ships managed to escape through the Hellespont intact. So, despite their best efforts, the Romans still found themselves scrambling after a Gothic army now loose in the Aegean Sea. As they sailed into the heart of Greece, the remaining Goths split into two groups, with one heading due south towards Crete and then Rhodes, while the other made for the mainland. It had been a good long time since the Greeks had had to deal with any kind of foreign threat, and the citizens of Athens and Sparta and the other old Greek city-states were shocked to find themselves suddenly scrambling to build walls around their cities in an attempt to fend off the Goths. The defense of Athens was led by a man named Dexippus, who, in the tradition of Xenophon and Thucydides, was a historian as well as a soldier and a statesman. Though only fragments of his work remain today, back when they were all still whole, late antiquity scholars relied heavily on the Greek historian's writings, which means that we owe him a debt of gratitude for helping shed at least some light on the convoluted 3rd century. When the Goths came knocking, though, helping some beleaguered future scholars was probably the last thing on Dexippus's mind. The Goths had appeared so suddenly that there was very little the Athenians could do to prevent the barbarians from overrunning their city, and Dexippus's fame as a soldier was earned not by preventing the Goths from sacking Athens, but instead by managing to revive the spirits of his neighbors and lead them in a decisive counterattack that finally drove the plundering Goths off. When they were done with Athens, the barbarians had headed south to the Peloponnese, where they sacked, among others, the city of Sparta. But as they headed back north, they were met by an army of irregulars raised by Dexippus, who put the surprised Goths into a hasty flight and drove them north right into the waiting embrace of Gallienus' approaching army. When he returned home, Dexippus found Athens was now a smoldering ruin. But, according to the famous anecdote, he also found that the great library had been left untouched. One of the Gothic chiefs had seen his men preparing to burn it down and put a stop to their plan, telling them that it was better to leave the Greeks preoccupied with their books so that they did not resume their previous warlike ways. When the Imperial Navy had sailed off to confront the Gothic fleet, Gallienus organized an army comprised of his mobile cavalry, the Praetorian cohort, and units from the Danube legions. While the Goths sacked Greece, Gallienus was speeding in from the west. He might not have been able to save the Greeks, but he could certainly smack down the marauding barbarians when they inevitably made their way back north to their homelands on the far side of the Danube. Now, I'm sure you're sick of hearing this as I am of saying it, but guess what? There's some confusion in the record about what happened next. The accepted version is that Gallienus intercepted the group who had been driven off by Dexippus and defeated them in a battle near the city of Nessus in Thrace. The problem is that Claudius Gothicus would win a very similar battle the next year, near the very similar-sounding city of Nisus, leading some to suppose that something might have gotten mixed up over the years. Maybe Claudius was given credit for Gallienus' victory, both because Constantine wanted to promote Claudius' memory and because everyone else wanted to damn Gallienus'. Or maybe Claudius' victory was the real one, and someone transposed a year, leading us to think that it occurred during Gallienus' reign. Or maybe there were two battles, with Gallienus and Claudius each winning a key victory. That's the version I'm going to go with, because it poses the fewest problems in trying to reconcile all the disparate facts and theories about what really happened. So in the history of Rome, both emperors will get their cookie. Gallienus' victory was by no means a complete one, though, and the Goths were allowed to head home unmolested, as long as they gave up what they had taken and promised to take no more on their way back north. The emperor would not have long to bask in the glow of his semi-victory, though, nor would he have the chance to follow up with the other Gothic hordes still loose within his empire. Unlike every other time Gallienus had marched out to battle, this time he did not follow the lead of his top general Aureolus. Instead, he left Aureolus in charge of the garrison at Milan, with instructions to keep an eye on both Postumus and the Alemanni, and make sure that neither took advantage of the emperor's absence. As soon as Gallienus left Italy, though, the only one who took advantage of his absence was Aureolus. For whatever reason, the emperor's favorite general decided that now was the perfect time to revolt. The motivations behind Aureolus' revolt are not at all clear, but broadly speaking, there are two schools of thought. Either Aureolus had always been trying to throw in his lot with Postumus, see his suspicious failure to defeat the Gallic emperor previously, or this was an entirely new idea, brought on possibly by the fact that he had been relieved of his command as the captain of the imperial cavalry and left behind to mind the shop while everyone else went off to fight the Goths. The man who took command of the cavalry, incidentally, was the man who was about to succeed Gallienus, Marcus Aurelius Valerius Claudius. When word came in 268 that his former right-hand man was now in revolt, Gallienus was forced to stop what he was doing, peel off most of the troops he had just raised to fight the Goths, and head them back to Italy. His eastern flank was already badly exposed by the death of Odenathus, and now Aureolus was exposing his western flank to a possible invasion by Postumus. Luckily for Gallienus, Postumus appears to have never indulged in ambitions beyond what he had already achieved. Despite Aureolus begging for aid, and even going so far as to use the mint in Milan to issue coins in Postumus' name, the Gallic emperor never lifted a finger to help Aureolus. There was just no profit in it. If he threw in with the usurping general, he risked everything that he had built. But if he did nothing, well, he risked nothing. And so he did nothing. When the imperial army returned to Italy, Aureolus and what troops he had at his disposal rode out to meet them, but they were easily routed and forced to flee back behind the walls of Milan. Gallienus settled in to lay siege to the city that he had just helped put on the map, and while he waited for Milan to fall, his officers began to talk amongst themselves. Though I did say last week that much of the supposed dissatisfaction with Gallienus can be traced back to the biases of the senatorial class, that does not mean that there was no dissatisfaction at all. It appears that a cabal of officers, many originating in Illyria, had begun to grow disenchanted with Gallienus' leadership. Just because defending the borders from invasion while simultaneously bringing Posthumus and the Palmyrenes to heel seemed really hard, well, that did not mean that it was impossible, and many of the career soldiers in the upper ranks believed that if they had a chance, that they could do a better job than Gallienus. Now, this is, of course, a common belief among, well, anyone who isn't actually in charge, but in this case, it may have been true. Aurelian, who was dealt almost exactly the same hand as Gallienus, was able to do in just 4 years what Gallienus had been unable to do in 8. So eventually, all this insubordinate talk became serious, and a plot was hatched. We will probably never know exactly how Gallienus was assassinated, nor who exactly was in on the plot, but the most dramatic account has it that the murder was the result of a clever ruse. Late in the evening, one of the conspirators burst into Gallienus's tent to tell the emperor that Aureolus was leading his men out of Milan on a night raid. Not even pausing to don his armor, Gallienus rushed out of his tent and mounted his horse to go assess the situation for himself, but as soon as he was caught alone and exposed outside the camp, he was cut down by the waiting assassins. It is, of course, debatable whether this particularly fantastic story is true, but there is no doubt that a conspiracy of top officers got together and killed Gallienus, maybe by the sword and maybe by poison, in 268 AD. Later revisions to history have Gallienus recommending Claudius as his successor, though it seems highly unlikely that Gallienus really spent his dying breaths making noble suggestions about the best man to succeed him. Gallienus was 50 years old, and had been emperor first with his father and then by himself for a remarkable 15 years. When Gallienus died, the officers did indeed rally around Claudius, the captain of the cavalry, which may help explain the later stories about, wink wink, Gallienus recommending Claudius for the job, and then the Senate fell quickly into line. If Aureolus thought the death of his former master would mean that he could extract himself peacefully from Milan, though, well, he was in for a bit of a surprise. Far from granting Aureolus amnesty, Claudius made it clear that everyone inside the city walls was as good as dead if Aureolus' head wasn't brought to him immediately. So, inside Milan, a similar conspiracy of officers dispatched with their chief, and then they came out to make peace with the new emperor, who, once Aureolus was dealt with, was feeling pretty magnanimous. He went so far as to order that Gallienus' family should not be harmed in any way, but the order didn't make it to Rome in time to stop the revenge-minded Senate from executing Gallienus' brother and Gallienus' son. Up in Gaul, Posthumus watched all of this with a mixture of satisfaction and concern. He had to have been pleased with himself for avoiding getting tangled up in the fight between Aureolus and Gallienus, which had now led to the assassination of both men. But a new leader in Rome meant new policies, and Posthumus had to have known Claudius, if not personally, then at least by reputation. And if Claudius's dissatisfaction with Gallienus in any way stemmed from the emperor's inability to reclaim the Gallic provinces, well, that didn't bode well for Posthumus at all. Fortunately, he would never have to face Rome's final attempt to recapture the West. Unfortunately, it's because he wound up, in the end, sharing the fate of Gallienus and Aureolus and Odenathus. Posthumus's rule had been mostly unopposed, but brief revolts or mutinies had flared up here and there in keeping with the times. In either 268 or early 269, one of his officers along the Rhine decided to make a bid for the throne and had himself declared emperor at his home base in Mainz. Posthumus quickly raised an army and marched in to put the usurper down, and in short order the revolt was squashed. The problem for Posthumus was that now his soldiers wanted to sack Mainz, to punish the city for its disloyalty, yes, but mostly to carry off the wealth of the city for themselves. But Posthumus was the emperor of everyone, and it really wouldn't do to let his army just go and sack one of the key urban centers of his domain, so he ordered the city left untouched. This ticked off his men something fierce, and in a fit of rage, they cornered Posthumus and killed him. The rash murder left the Gallic Empire without a leader, and after some confusion, one of Posthumus's officers, a man named Marcus Aurelius Marius, finally stepped forward and attempted to seize power. But he only lasted a few days before being brushed aside and killed by a man named Victorianus, who came from an extremely wealthy family, and whose mother apparently opened up the family bank accounts to buy her son the throne. The near simultaneous deaths of Odenathus, Gallienus, and Posthumus brought to a close the second phase of the crisis of the 3rd century. At the beginning of Phase 3, their successors will duke it out to see whose vision of the future will reign supreme. In the East, Zenobia dreamed of creating a permanent, independent Palmyrene Empire. In the West, Victorianus dreamed of simply trying to hold together what Posthumus had built. And in the middle, Claudius and his soon-to-be successor Aurelian dreamed of reunification. All three would have to deal with persistent threats to their frontiers, from the Sassanids and from the Goths and from the Franks and from the Alemanni, all of whom dreamed their own dreams of what the fate of the Roman Empire ought to be. I hate to do this so soon after taking a week off, but there will be no episode next week, as the History of Rome is heading down south to San Antonio to cheer on Mrs. The History of Rome as she runs her half marathon. But we will, of course, be back in 2 weeks for the short reign of Claudius, and then the totally impressive reign of Aurelian, who has fast become one of the History of Rome's most favorite emperors.